Alright, this is admittedly a tough question, so all mercy. Some may be thinking that it was one of the founding fathers who wrote the Constitution or the Declaration of Independence. Others might be thinking some political thinker of the 1700s. It was actually Pope St. Gregory VII, of the year roughly 1050. I know, it surprised me too when I was looking into this for my master's thesis that the church herself was the first to coin the idea of the separation of church and state. During his papacy, Gregory saw the problems inherent in secular kings and lords investing bishops and cardinals, giving them considerable influence in the election of popes and the government of the church. And so he sought, therefore, to establish this separation in powers and responsibilities between the church and the state. Interestingly enough, though, even though he was the first to establish it authoritatively, like put it into force, he was still not the first to come up with the idea. We see this distinction between religious authority and secular authority throughout the Bible. In the New Testament, both Peter and Paul call for prayers to be offered for Caesar and for those in positions of authority, thus recognizing their offices as legitimate and to be respected, which was a big question at that time. Even in the Old Testament, God establishes the kingship of David alongside those of the priests and the prophets to be a distinct office all its own. Our gospel today has Jesus declaring to us that there are duties that are owed to the state as well as those owed to God. When he says, give back to Caesar what belongs to Caesar and what belongs to God, and give to God what belongs to God, he's saying that these are different offices in their own right, their own roles and responsibilities. So what all of this together shows us is that even within God's plan of salvation, there is a place for both church and state. Both are crucial in their own right, and it would be wrong for one to assume the role and responsibilities of the other. Where problems arise with this, however, is when people try to push for a complete divorce between the two. Notice that to this point, I've been saying that there is a distinction in roles and powers, as opposed to that the two are completely different and separate entities or sort of juxtaposed to each other. The two are distinct and separate in terms of their operations and their purposes, but they are meant to work together like cogs in a machine, working for the best possible goods for both society and humanity as a whole. The purpose of the state is to serve and protect the people within the state, settling disputes between citizens and creating laws that help preserve the safety and well-being of that citizen. While the purpose of the church is to work for the salvation of souls, to help us to take care of those who are in need, whether we're talking materially and or spiritually. Those works do often go hand in hand. So both church and state are called to work together to find the best possible solution. So then how does this relate to all of us individually? We've been talking about the institutions. What about us, the individuals? Many people today tend to talk about the separation of church and state, not so much in terms of separating the institutions, but more in terms of separating religion from politics in general. I want to be clear, that's just not possible. Religion, properly speaking, it's not just an institution or set of prayers. Religion, properly speaking, is a belief system, a frame of mind. It is a way, really the way, in which we see the world. We see God, we see each other. By that definition, then, even atheism can be said to be a religion. A person is going to act and make decisions based on what they believe. We will for Jesus' coming to earth was that humanity's conscience had been affected by sin, such that what we thought was truly good turned out to actually not be so good after all, neither for ourselves nor for others. Jesus came to show us the true way. So it is now our responsibility to form our consciences according to what he has revealed to us. We do this naturally by the most obvious means, reading the Bible, by reading the teachings of the saints, but also by listening to the teachings of the church, specifically in cases of voting, by looking into the voting guides of the USCCB and the rest of the church puts out. With that last one, it is important to remember that the church is not just some political party or organization. The church is the mystical body of Christ, with the Holy Spirit dwelling within her, to act through her and to speak through her. When she teaches things like abortion is a sin, it is not just some political statement. It is a moral statement that can be found in the fifth commandment and at least half a dozen other places throughout both Old and New Testaments alike. When she says that we are to be pro-life, it is to say that all human beings are sacred and that they are created in the image and likeness of God. And therefore, they're all to be respected. We are all to be respected and protected from conception all the way to natural death. The reason she says that issues like abortion and euthanasia and other pro-life issues are preeminent issues is that they are the basis for all other rights. I mean, really think about it. How can we talk about protecting this or that type of person or their rights if we cannot even agree on what constitutes a person in the first place and why that might be important? The most important thing in all of this is that as we navigate this world and the struggles that we encounter within it, we are striving to live our lives for God. Each of our readings today calls us to remember that our greatest allegiance is to God, that while we live in the world, we are not of the world. We are for God. When we come to this altar, we are offering our lives in sacrifice so that we might be transformed and made more and more perfectly into the image and likeness of Christ. May this celebration today transform us more fully, more perfectly, so that we might speak and act and love more in the imitation of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise be Jesus Christ.